6:45, take one.
Quiet, please. Put the mic around. Thanks.
Stereo.
Ready? Yeah. Action.
John, could you just sort of tell me how the show evolved, how you originated this first idea to get a show like Monty Python on TV?
Yes, well, when Graham and I came off the halls, we used to do an act with electric seals. We went into the business of writing for David Frost.
Oh, yes.
Shh. And after a time working for Frost...
The tough days, aren't they?
Shh. We decided we were getting on a bit and we needed someone to support us in our old age.
You know, give us some money and things like that.
A little bit of effort, go to the editing and dubbing sessions is kind of thing. And we looked around at the shows that were on television and we thought the worst of a pretty poor bunch was Complete and Utter History of Britain, England, what was it called?
I don't remember now.
I don't know, it's rapidly forgotten.
I remember,
it's
also the 48
then
show.
Do not,
Do Not Adjust Your
Children's Show.
And there were a couple of very young people. We managed to find out their names by ringing up the relevant company. And they agreed to work for an extremely small sum of money for us and for the BBC. And so we thought they were the ideal people to get together.
So this is how the show first got off
right,
the ground. I see.
Right.
Do you find it sort of much strain keeping up with a show like this?
How do we keep going up?
Going up all over the place, various locations and...
Yes. Yeah.
It's very boring.
You find it a great
story. Very tedious. Also, the other three are not very nice. So this creates...
Tremendous tension there is.
Yes.
Enormous personal
So you don't really get
the amount
on
of bitching that goes
together.
On. I mean, it's incredible, isn't it?
Yeah,
it really is.
Well, it gets
you don't get
nasty
on at all well together.
Bitch.
Sorry we're late. They gave you a few details. Got held up on the way.
Have you got any future plans for another series after this at all?
Well, we're certainly not going to work with the other two.
We're hoping to
more
send...
Do Not Adjust Yourself?
Yes, we're hoping to send John back to David Frost, really.
Do you want to try and get rid of him if you can?
If he can get his job back, you know. He did get, you know, there's a bit of a nasty business when he went to the Frost.
I don't think he wants to. No,
sorry.
No. If he can get on doing something different, you know, it'd be marvellous.
How do you like working for the BBC?
I hate it.
You don't think the
food's bad.
The food is bad.
That's the one good thing about it.
The beds are bad too, aren't they?
The offices are small.
Now for something completely different.
Is that a link?
Right. It's Monty Python, the Flying Circus.
If you have never seen Monty Python's Flying Circus before, you would probably think that the people who write it are mad, and the people who appear in it are mad, and the BBC is mad to put on such a programme. But you might also think that it is hilariously funny. You might be surprised to learn that although all the Monty Python team are funny, they're not mad, and the only mad thing about the BBC, it is not letting half the country watch the programme. Graham Chapman, John Cleese, Terry Gilliam, Eric Idle, Terry Jones, and Michael Palin. The names are familiar. Their brand of humour has developed from the Frost programme onto, at last, the 1948 show, The Complete and Utter History of Great Britain, and more recently, the children's programme, Do Not Adjust Your Set. Their type of humour is unusual, and Monty Python is certainly no exception. It is zany, fast-moving, and very often it has an underlying and satirical motive. I discovered while talking to the cast that a natural aversion to pompous bureaucracy and such things as the old-school tie network, the upper-class twits, for instance, poking fun at the type of people who believe that they are the chosen few. Possibly it is easier to make fun at stockbrokers rather than the working class, but really most of their comedy is completely original and fresh. But it seems to me rather unfortunate that the BBC have treated the programme rather coolly. It was transmitted late, very often at an unearthly hour, on a Sunday evening in the first series, when most people had gone to bed. And for the current series, the Tuesday 10 o'clock spot was chosen, which happens to be the time when the regions can put out their own programmes. It is a shame that the BBC seems less interested in these sort of creative productions, but more in sort of sport and outside broadcast. However, the Monty Python team have been given every encouragement by the production staff. Ian McNaughton, the director, obviously has great sympathy for the Python humour, and it is vital for such a complicated programme to have someone dedicated and utterly professional at the helm. I asked Eric Idle how the team first got together to produce such a programme.
We just sort of talked. We were both doing different sorts of shows. We were doing a show called Do Not Adjust Your Set, which is a kid's show. John came along with an idea of doing a show together and sort of thought we would like to get away from separate, you know, set sketches which stopped and started and try and get it sort of integrated much more. That's the way it is, basically. We just talk.
It takes an enormous amount of time, this show. Far more than the average comedy show. I mean, say, Graham Chapman and I working together could write the average situation comedy very easily in 5 days, 6 days. But to write one of these would take us, working at the same rate, at least 2.5 and probably 3 weeks, because there's so many more ideas. You know, a situation comedy, you get one idea and a subsidiary idea, and then you develop it. I mean, it's something like this. Per half hour, the audience really gets its money worth in terms of the number of ideas. I don't mean they all work. The amount of work that goes in terms of thinking up all these ideas is enormous compared with any other comedy show.
And the debates. You know, a good debate is just fabulous.
If you have material, you sort of link it together and you've got to think about it and put it together. And it just evolved, really. You know, we had certain ideas, somebody come up with a sketch and say, yes, that's a bit old-fashioned, why don't we do it? You know, basically, I mean, the major changes came when you brought in a sketch which you'd written individually, and somebody say, yes, I like that much of it, and only that much works, the rest of it's very set. Yeah. Let's go and do something else with it.
The rest of television comedy is perhaps a bit limited to situation. You know, there isn't... There hasn't been much of this kind of comedy for quite a time. Young people prefer this show because we're younger and we, the kind of things we write about appeal to young people.
I think we just do it for ourselves, you know. Find ourselves funny.
Well, I've been going with ministers for 5 years now and, you know, I think they're wonderful.
Oh, yes. I like civil servants.
Oh, yes, they're nice.
I like speaker.
Oh, yeah.
I like black road.
We don't have anything in it we don't think's funny. This sounds a bit silly, but I mean, it's only for us. You can't say that it's aimed at anybody, because that's silly. I mean, who do you aim it at? He may not like it when you've aimed it at him.
I think on the whole it probably does appeal to young people more, because their minds are slightly more open. They're not expecting a sort of set sketch. I think a lot of older viewers think it's just purely silly and not worth listening to, because it's not a conventional sketch, say, with a beginning and an end, and then you have a guest star or something like that. They don't really know where they are with it, and because they're expecting that more formal kind of show, I think they more or less turn their minds off. They don't actually listen to what's happening. But younger people who are less set in their ways are more prepared to accept it.
It's as simple as this. We really do what we find funny. It's just as simple as that. And it so happens that younger people, whose minds are far more flexible and often probably find themselves more in tune with our way of thinking, as well as being faster, they may be more sort of politically the same, they're going to pick it up. But the surprising thing to me is, for example, that the cabbies, who are a very friendly, cheerful but fascist lot in London, they all seem to like it. And my parents now are beginning to like it. I think, like the Goon Show, you see, people who don't take to it immediately sometimes develop a taste for it.
Go on! Camp it! Up! Ooh, get her once! I'll scratch your eyes out. Don't come the bigger thing with us, dear. We all know where you've been, you military fairy.
People say it's daft, and it is. What kind of an argument is it? You don't know what to say. This is why when we were asked about the show, to begin with in particular, all we ever said about it is that it was very silly. And I think when people heard that we thought it was very silly, they slightly relaxed.
You have a show like Monty Python, which has, at the present time, rather like the Goon Show in the early days, a very small but very loyal following. It seems a great shame that it simply gets shoved into the background. And after a time you wonder why, because, I mean, Don't Ask Us is very nice, you know, but it's terribly, terribly inoffensive. It's terribly conventional, and it does lots of little sort of things that people have been doing for years and years, and it does them very well. It's a little bit dissatisfying when you think you're doing a show that is ahead of that.
in terms of content and form, and the thing just is treated like a little eccentric programme.
On the same, and then out to that, and there's Graham in the same room. All right, Terry?
I have a feeling that the only attitude really with television is that while everyone should try the whole time to do the very best they can, so that even if they're doing a very run-of-the-mill show, they just give it an edge, just try and make it that little bit better each time, that little bit more, a little bit different, not just utterly stick to the form. I think you have to really hope for a situation in which all types of shows are done. And I think the sad thing is that people jump on bandwagons. A nice thing would be is if you had something wild like Monty Python, a couple of good situation things, maybe Alf Garnett or Steptoe, then you've got to have a couple of Dear Fathers, you know, middle class or not in front of the children, that's fine. A satirical show or two running, a really even madder one like maybe Q5, a much more solid base one in reality, like the civil service thing that John Burton and Dudley Foster are doing. But the thing to do is to get a really wide spectrum, but it tends not to happen. It tends to be all, at the moment, nearly all middle class type of situation comedy.
Right, here we go. Turn over.
I have about 4 wigs. Short wigs. It's very good. I was refused entry into the studio last week and I took one of my wigs off.
Yeah.
I came back with my own hair. The commissioner wouldn't let me in. He didn't believe I was in the show. I said, I wear short wigs. And he looked at me very dubiously. He was very angry.
The money we get for Monty Python is fairly small. I don't mind telling you at all. I mean, I get £5,000 for this series, which is a very nice whack of money. But it's for eight and a half months' work. And very solid work, and this is long hours most days, because it's not just rehearsing and writing, there's the whole business of editing the shows after they're done and dubbing, and we probably work 3 to 4 evenings a week as well as the ordinary days. It's very seldom really that we get a free weekend in this business, in fact, for what it's worth, because it's an overpaid business. You could be earning a great deal more money than that, but because we like doing it, we're prepared to take what is in fact a cut in our overpaid potential salary in order to do something that we like. I mean, it's very difficult to stick your neck out and say, you know, it's better than this or better than that, but your feeling is that it's more interesting. It's basically it's trying to do so much more than most of these shows.
Monty Python's Flying Circus has been criticised for going too far and even for being dirty. Some of you might agree. Anyway, it could never be shown on American television. But it was felt that Americans might like to sample a little of the humour. So the team at present are making a film specially for the American market. Most of the sketches have been taken directly from the first TV series, but this time with the help of censorship. Although the BBC have never shown the programme at a peak hour, no sponsor has ever had the chance to cut anything from the show in the belief that it may offend one of his potential consumers. We must consider ourselves lucky that we see Monty Python's Flying Circus, how it was originally conceived and performed.
But this isn't the only hospital where doctors' conditions are improving.
We've every facility here for dealing with people who are rich. We can deal with a blocked purse, we can drain private accounts, and in the worst cases, we can perform a total cachectomy, which is total removal of all monies from the patient.
Well, here we try to help people who have to link sketches together. We try to stop them saying, have you ever wondered what it would be like if, and instead to say something like,
And now for something completely different.